Hi, welcome to episode 3. This episode's called The Beautiful Fallen, which is a reference to the Venn, an ancient culture that is the inspiration for 2 of my role-playing games. For this episode, I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about the concept of setting and system and the apparent conflict between the two in role-playing game design. Now, I'm of the opinion that these two things, setting and system, are not only not in conflict with each other, but are essentially must be harmonious. I'm wearing a t-shirt today, which is my Arkham Fire Department t-shirt. It's in reference to Call of Cthulhu, which is the first role-playing game I bought and learned how to play and learned how to run. And that was one of, and I think that had a profound impact on the way that I look at role-playing games. Call of Cthulhu, while it uses a generic system, it has a unique mechanic, the sanity mechanic, which really differentiated it from a lot of other games. Call of Cthulhu is a horror game, and so it has a mechanic that reminds the players, a tick-tock, tick-tock reminder that their characters are breaking down emotionally. And that really said a lot to me as a young player and as a game designer when I got older. I felt that it was vitally important for a character sheet to remind the player at all times where he is. Not that he's sitting in, you know, the living room or at the library or anything like that, but he's in the setting. And so for Houses of the Blooded, one of the things I wanted to do, one of the things I wanted to accomplish was have the character sheet constantly remind the player where he is. He's in the world of Shanri, which is what the Venn called the world around them. It translates as the enemy. And yes, the Venn literally believed that the world was out to get them. And more than that, I didn't want to make an archaeological game. I didn't want to make GURPS the Venn. What I wanted to do was I wanted to make a game that allowed you to recreate the fiction or the literature of the people. So it wasn't a historical game, but it was a game that was more in tune with the plays and operas and books of the Venn. In other words, instead of doing a French swashbuckling game that reflected the time period or reflected the historical characters, doing an Alexandre Dumas Three Musketeers game, a game that represented the literature rather than the history. Now, a very quick aside. I have to admit that another reason that I chose to do something about Venn literature rather than history is so all the armchair historians would get off my back. So using the Venn as the chief inspiration for the game, I wanted to make sure that every element of the game somehow reflected Venn's philosophy. The primary way of doing that was having the what are commonly called attributes or traits in the game specifically reflect the virtues that the Venn revered most. Things like beauty and courage, strength, and military prowess, or the ability to use a weapon. These things I felt were primary in the hearts of the Venn, so they should be primary in the heart of the game. Not only that, but since you are playing a noble in the game and not a barbarian wanderer sellsword, the houses of Venn nobility should also play a primary role in the game. Thus, the name of the game, Houses of the Blooded. The Venn believed in their own mythology, their own creation myth, that they were created by an older race, the sorcerer kings, of whom they were unmentionable, could not speak of them for fear that they might return someday, and that their blood was magical. And there's the blooded part of the title. And the Venn had divided themselves into noble houses, which were represented in the Senate, and thus the houses of the game. So in the game, you are born under the shadow of one of the houses. You belong to one of the houses. Even if you're playing a peasant, which you can do, but why? Even if you want to play a peasant, you are still born under the shadow of a house. So the first thing you do in the game is you select a house. And the 6 houses, the 6 unveiled houses of the Senate at the current time in the game, are the House of the Bear, the Elk, the Falcon, the Fox, the House of the Serpent, and the House of the Wolf. These are the 6 totemic animals, again, sacred animals of the Venice Senate. And each of them represented, or embraced, I should say, a particular virtue. For the bear, that virtue was strength. For the elk, it was cunning. For the falcon, it was courage. For the fox, it was beauty. For the serpent, it was wisdom. And for the wolf, it was prowess. And so I wanted these six primary things to be part of the game in a very real way, and so they became the character attributes. Your character has these attributes at ranks from 2 to 5, and so these are the primary cornerstones of the game system. Whenever your character takes a risk, you roll a number of dice equal to the character's virtue, the most appropriate virtue. So virtues aren't exactly attributes, they're not what you do, but they become more like philosophies, which is how you accomplish things. Do you accomplish things through cunning, or do you accomplish things through pure physical force? Or do you accomplish things through knowing the wicked ways of the world, having wisdom? What do you do to overcome risk? And so these became the virtues, or the primary attributes of the game. But I also wanted to represent the fact that in Venn literature, every character has a primary weakness. And so, while there are 6 main virtues, each character only has 5. One virtue you don't have at all. You'll never have, as a matter of fact. And it's always a 0. So while 5 of the virtues are ranked from 2 to 5, one virtue will always, always, always be ranked at 0. You'll never have it. And this is the first key component to giving characters weakness, which is what I wanted in the game. It came from a response of watching other characters in other games eventually compensate for their weaknesses through experience points. And what's the point of having a weakness especially if you're playing a game that's meant to emulate literature, fantasy literature, if you can just overcome it? Why can't Elric, for example, who's an albino, just do push-ups and lift weights? Why can't he ever become stronger? Because the primary core of his character is that he's physically weak. Why can't a character like Raistlin from Dragonlance do the same thing? Why can't he just use magic to heal his inner wounds and become stronger? Because being weak is one of his characteristics. Look at any character from literature that we adore, and we adore him not only for his strengths but for his weaknesses. And imagine if that character had experience points, what's the first thing that he would do? He would use his experience points to get rid of his weakness. So again, it's a case of trying to make the game reflect the literature. The characters have faults. They have flaws. They have weaknesses. And you can't just do something as benign as spend experience points to get rid of them. At least not in my game.